Tonight, in this season's last program, dealing with the nation 99 years after Confederation, a look at the resources of waterfowl and marshes and the important role they play in the lives of Canadians today. To me, there is no more nostalgic sound in the world than the haunt cry of wildfowl as they follow the ancient courses of migration. Poets, painters, and composers have tried over the years to capture the theme of nature, for man has always existed side by side with settlers and helped his livelihood for some, and at the same time contributes to the nation's economy through hunting and tourism. But perhaps more importantly, the marshes and adjoining acres which provide for the propagation of this waterfowl can become also a last refuge for man himself. For many, it's a world that is taken for granted, like winds and sunsets.
As I wandered alone in the marshland, through the tall grass silent and still, saw the muskrat at work while the blackbird chirped, the coyote lurking round for the kill. Have you ever been out in the marshland at the eerie breaking of dawn, heard the lone heron cry, seen the goshawk fly as the wind in the grass joins the song? And it calls me still, and it calls me still. Come back to the marshland. We're fading fast away.
Even before you saw them, you knew they were there. The great V formations of Canada geese on wing from the south, honking loudly as they came. The long winter was over. The ice was gone from Scroggie's pond, and it was spring once more on the Canadian prairies.
Ha 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 ha!
In grandfather's day, so he told me, the waters in these parts were alive with geese. And on some days, the clouds of ducks were thick enough to blot out the sun itself. It wasn't quite like that when I was a boy, but the ducks still were there in countless numbers. And it remained a fascinating world, this world of the prairie marshes. To a growing boy, it offered that most priceless of gifts, solitude, along with the teeming complex of nature that satisfied both eye and ear. From the courtship antics of the Western grebe, you learn something about nature's passion, or perhaps it was only vanity. The point of all this activity was simple. It was mating season in the marsh, and the female wanted a male. And as one discovered again later in life, the female generally had her way. It was late spring and the marsh was an active world. There in the long marsh grass, you felt the first stirring of that satisfying state known as contemplation. You saw the whole life cycle compressed into 6 short months, and it was both glorious and mysterious. Birds paired off with an admirable fidelity, staked their claims to a piece of land, and fought off all intruders. My grandfather saw in this a reverence for private property, and it seemed to him a worthy lesson in conservative politics. Small C. Eternal vigilance is the price of freedom. So went another lesson of the marsh. Along with, strike first and ask questions later. It was all too often a world of unequal opposition, of some apparent love, but no apparent pity. The predators were everywhere and variously armed. In unseen places, eggs were laid and the young were born. Some to die casually, many to be destroyed violently by other residents of the marsh. Watching it all at the age of 12, you learned one more useful fact about this universe, that all things, great and small, live off things that are smaller still. It was a hard concept to reconcile with a benevolent deity, but in time, you learned acceptance, and thenceforth were more at one with nature. April became June, and the strident cries of spring softened into a warmer stillness. It was summer on the prairies. The survivors were abroad on the ponds and somewhat more secure. The hunted ones of May preparing to become the hunters of July. It was feeding time for the many young families of the marsh. The pied-billed grebes, the baby sandpipers, the black-crowned night herons. And the strange-looking baby bitterns, with both parents on the alert. Along with the ever-present sentinel of the marsh, the Canada goose. School was out. Your hands and feet were in the water, and your head was somewhere in the future. Even then, you knew that one day you would leave the marsh. And so you did. Or at any rate, I did. Only to return again as a grown man, drawing on remembered vitality of a boyhood setting and relaxing into the healing world of nature. There was pride in the ability to still distinguish between an avocet and a golden plover. You go back to the marsh in the summer of the year, acutely aware that it's a priceless asset in this land of ours, and increasingly conscious that it lives now in a growing state of siege.
As far as I'm concerned, I couldn't care less whether we have ducks around or not. I like to see them all right, but I would just as soon if those ducks were on somebody else's land.
It wouldn't bother us very much if we never saw the ducks at all.
I think it would be very foolish, and I think we would be sorry, or future generations, that if we upset the balance of nature too drastically.
One concerned Canadian. There are others, but in most cases, the voices of progress are louder and stronger. As one Western farmer put it, prairie agriculture has only progressed at the expense of the buffalo and the coyote. Why should we let ducks stand in our way? The need for farmland in a growing nation is understandable. And as our country grows, so too grows the need for additional living space, As civilization advances, our wilderness areas become depleted, and things wild, beautiful, and free are depleted with them. Now, this message from the life insurance companies in Canada. The great Canadian prairies are known the world over for their grain and livestock production. Most people visualize this part of Canada as an area where flat farmlands and wheat fields stretch endlessly to a horizon broken only by the familiar grain elevators. But existing side by side with the farmlands are the prairie marshlands. Bodies of shallow water spread throughout the land in various shapes and sizes. Farm sloughs formed in a low-lying part of a prairie drainage system. Potholes created when the great glacial lakes receded, leaving thousands of indentations scattered through what is now productive farmland, and the great open marshes, fed by the overflow of lake waters, bordered by tall yellow reeds and dotted with islands of bulrushes and cattails. 70 miles west of Winnipeg lies the Delta Marsh, one of the largest in the Canadian wheat belt, stretching 19 miles in length and as wide as 5 miles in places. It's one of the finest waterfowl breeding areas in North America, and as recently as a decade ago, one could still travel through the heart of this marshland and see hundreds of thousands of waterfowl rise from the water to darken the sky. The marsh grows quieter each year, and sometimes the solitude is broken only by the swish of a paddle and the voices of people concerned with the changes.
Leave the paddles in? Yeah. The prairies begin shooting in the far north in early September, and shooting continues right on until after Christmas in the south.
Do you think that people generally realize the seriousness of the situation?
Well, I think here they do, in central Manitoba. You've seen a few ducks we saw today. Sometimes in this marsh, a man can go out, not even see his limit, much less shoot it.
Yeah.
And the whole Lake Manitoba Basin is virtually without birds. Here at Delta, this is the third or fourth year where there have been very few ducks in the fall.
Where
and, well, some say they're going down through Ontario.
I can guarantee they're not.
Some say they're going down the Rocky Mountains. Some say they're still north. Some say they went through before the season started.
Mm-hmm. They said the same thing about the passenger pigeon about 75
years ago. Yes, they
did. But the answer to the passenger pigeon situation, of course, was that passenger pigeons are extinct.
Well, let's go,
Al Hochbaum, ornithologist, artist, and writer, first came to Manitoba's Delta Marsh in 1938 for postgraduate studies. He remained to become director of the Delta Waterfowl Research Station, a venture supported by the North American Wildlife Foundation and private contributors. Each year, students from all parts of the world come to the station to study waterfowl in their natural habitat and to continue research work under laboratory conditions at the edge of the Great Delta Marsh. In 1955, six trumpeter swans were brought to Delta. This resulted in the first successful captive breeding of this rare species in North America. It's an encouraging sign, for although the trumpeter swans once existed in great numbers throughout America, they were reduced to near extinction by 1900. Other species have vanished. The passenger pigeons, Carolina parakeets, and the Labrador ducks. And in this century, there's been a continuing decline in the entire waterfowl population. And when one returns to the favorite haunts of his youth, as Tom Benson did, the changes become
tragically apparent.
The difference to me between now and 20 years ago is just absolutely fantastic. What are some of the species that have really declined?
Well,
redheads for one, I suppose.
Redheads and canvasback have declined seriously. Their decline is acknowledged by law. They've been protected, but the strangest, most unbelievable thing has been the decline of the mallard, which we always thought of as being indestructible. Mm-hmm. The mallard was once a common bird here, not a common duck, a common bird with robins and song sparrows. Mm-hmm. Now it's a rare species, hard to find as a nester. Mm-hmm. A few pairs scattered here and now, here and there, where 10 years ago there were hundreds of birds.
What does civilization, the expansion of civilization, have to do with it, do you think?
Well, a great deal. 25 years ago, people would take a whole day to come out from Winnipeg to shoot. Shoot the next day. Now, they leave Winnipeg at noon. Many of them have the evening shoot, go back the same night. The marshes are much more accessible now.
Accessible. And in our free society, this means that anybody can escape the crowds and crush of the cities in man's instinctive compulsion to return to nature. But more and more, he finds elbow room at a premium. The skilled and patient hunter is often forced to yield his chosen area to a new breed of frontiersman.
What's going to happen to the marsh bird in a few years
Ron,
from now?
I don't know. I don't know what is the answer. If your population was to increase by another 100%, where are you going to find the room? There won't be room for them. There will be less ducks. And I'm not sure that there is any remedy within the scope of government, or even within the scope of ethical behavior, that's going to save that situation.
Bert Fair lives in Winnipeg, Manitoba. An active outdoorsman, Mr. Fair was one of a small group responsible for introducing the Hungarian partridge to Canada. At 83, he still enjoys the rewards of hunting, and at the end of a long and pleasant day in the marsh, he sometimes reminisces with men like Rod Ducharme, who has been a guide most of his life.
Rod, do you think there's any difference in the ethics of hunters today than there was in the old days?
And there is a lot of difference in the hunter, Bert. Today, we have a lot of hunters, and they don't even have any rubber boat or dog, and they just start to walk in the grass. And they start to shoot them ducks, and they'll knock 12 ducks down, and approximately they'll pick up two. And we have an awful lot of them hunters. We call them sidewalk hunters.
Thank you.
I stayed at the landing until dark. Them guys were drinking it in the car. Now, them kind of hunters, it's just a nuisance to have them guys around the marsh. They're just through what we call a destroyer. Go there and drink and shoot a few geese and not pick them up bird. And it was so dark, and them boys were kept on shooting, and I didn't know what they were shooting at. I think they were shooting at the moon. And the geese were coming in heavy. And you could hear them geese falling all over in the rushes, and they haven't picked them. Them geese are still laying there. Well, I think there should be something done about that bird.
If it was your boy that did that, you could teach him. I doubt if you could teach me if I had that habit. I'd be too old. The greatest hope lies in trying to teach the boy as he grows up what is good sportsmanship.
There are men who will ravage the marshland, but they know not what they destroy. For the creed of this land they would understand had they roamed in the marsh as a boy. And it calls me still, and it calls me still. Come back to the marshland, 'cause we're fading fast away.
The problem of the increasing number of hunters in the marshland, coupled with the continuing decline of waterfowl, is recognized. Each season, legislation is introduced to ease the hunting pressure and protect those species whose numbers are down. But in other problem areas, little or no effective measures are taken.
I've come across vast areas of marshland around here that's being used for fill, garbage, and any kind of unwanted material. And that in turn makes the marshes unusable.
Yes, and in this Great Lake Manitoba Basin, the marshes are being made unusable by the hay economy. This is this great, rich marshland is gradually changing from an area of duck production to an area of hay production. This is what we want. Much of it's public land. And this is what we as a people want. We want hay, not ducks.
A question of value. The per acre yield of ducks brings dollars to the country from hunting. But the per acre yield of hay results in direct monies to the farmers and hay operators. More often than not, it's haying that gets the first call.
We're letting a great resource run down the drain here in the Lake Manitoba Basin and in the other lakes of our great inland waters of Manitoba.
Down in Minnesota, I saw a report not very long ago, Minnesota and North Dakota. The same thing is happening, only in a different way. They're draining them down there for agricultural.
Yes, they've been draining steadily for the last 15 years, and many rich marshlands have vanished. Whole counties of marshes are gone.
Farmlands replacing marshlands in the heart of the Central Flyway. In western Minnesota, there were originally some 20,000 square miles of sizable pothole marshes. Today, there remain fewer than 20 square miles of unspoiled habitat. Grady Mann of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service at Fergus Falls, Minnesota, talks about the original pothole breeding range.
Actually, it extends from the southeastern part of Alberta, cuts across Saskatchewan, takes in the southwestern part of Manitoba, drops down into North Dakota, South Dakota, originally extended into Iowa, and takes in the western part of Minnesota. It's a highly important part of our waterfowl production scene on the North American continent. oftentimes producing up to 70% of the continental population each year. We know for certain that we have lost practically all of the habitat of the zone that is now in black. In the past, there have been several incentives for the farmer to drain marshes and potholes of the prairie region. This is probably one of the major things that has accelerated it and has accelerated the loss of valuable wildlife lands.
Many of these incentives have been in the form of federal assistance and subsidization. The cry for increased food production has meant increased drainage, resulting in the depletion of more than one-third of the original 127 million acres of wetlands in the United States. Many agriculturally minded people have happily watched the marshlands disappear, but some, like Eldon Rost, county agricultural agent for Alexandria, Minnesota, feel that much of the wide-scale reclamation of the land has been carried out thoughtlessly.
I've seen some drainage in this county that probably should never have been done. I don't think our county has the severe drainage problems that we have in some of the neighboring areas and some of the southern Minnesota counties. But we've had drainage take place here in hopes that land would become more useful for agriculture, and actually some of the things that have been drained or the areas that have been drained will probably never be sustaining as agricultural property.
A barren land where no grain grows and no waterfowl thrive. A wasteland created by a generation too often unconcerned about the future.
It's a general idea among most people up and down the street that it doesn't make too much difference what we do here. Those ducks will always come from Canada.
Well, what's the reason for that? Do they think that this great big duck factory, as they call it, is going to continue forever up here so that they can waste their resources?
I made a study of the situation in Minnesota and the Dakotas, and again and again and again, I talked to people and farmers, and the farmer's son or his wife said, we just hated to drain that slough. That's where Grandpa showed Johnny where to shoot his first duck. That's where my father showed me where to hunt. And yet, we couldn't afford not to drain them. And besides, they would say, and besides, Canada is full of these potholes and sloughs and potholes. And we can always go to Canada for our duck shooting. And we can always count on Canada for the production of these waterfowl. And yet, one of the finest breeding ranges in North America is the Minnedosa pothole country of western Manitoba. And here, sloughs are being lost. Sloughs and potholes are being lost at the rate of 2 or 3% a year.
Compared with the losses in the United States, a drainage rate of 2 or 3% per year may seem slight, but project these figures over 10, 20, or 30 years, and it becomes obvious that the time has come when we must make a choice. It isn't simply a matter of demanding that all drainage be stopped. Up to now, the farmer has not had many sound reasons for keeping the water on his land.
The potholes do not give us any grain, and the water is spoiling all the land around it. So we figure it is our benefit to get the water going. Drained a lot of sloughs. We intend to drain more. It is certainly cutting down on the duck population, which we haven't had too much pleasure out of. Been mostly trouble. And if anybody followed the combine after ducks had been on the swath, they would definitely see. Anywhere in a wet fall, 10 to 12 swaths gone on a field. We still have problems of the hunters driving over swaths. And if they would just pick up their beer bottles or drink someplace else, we would be very happy.
I like to see the hunters hunting in my land because I figure that they chase the ducks away. I figure most of the hunters are pretty decent fellows anyway, and they haven't really caused me any trouble. I never post my land.
Over the past number of years, there's been a great increase in the number of potholes that have been drained, and from the farmer's standpoint of view, this is quite logical. However, if this is continued, we're going to run out of breeding places for ducks. The hunters aren't going to be happy, and the farmer is going to have to be compensated somehow and to keep these potholes on his land.
Ducks Unlimited, along with other private agencies, have been actively engaged in the task of creating new breeding areas and have publicly stressed the need to conserve our vanishing marshes. But by far the most important problem area lies in the contest of farmlands versus wetlands. Dr. D.A. Munro, chief of the Canadian Wildlife Service, had this to say.
The federal government believes that the production of a public resource on private land should result in some tangible benefit to the landowner. So we plan to pay the owners of land surrounding potholes if they agree not to drain or fill or destroy those wetlands. The rate of payment will be based upon the value of the surrounding lands. The operational phase will get underway in 1967 and it will cost about $50 million. We hope to preserve more than 3/4 of the existing prairie wetlands, a total of 4 million acres.
Preserving their habitat is vital to the future of waterfowl. But if and when effective measures are taken to reduce the drainage, we may very well still face the prospect of a continuing decline.
This is one of the saddest features of our present waterfowl situation, that even though there is this constant aggression against marshes through drainage, and the loss of marshes is going ahead at a rapid rate, still there are not enough ducks to fill the existing breeding grounds, the greatly reduced breeding grounds, still not enough ducks to fill our reduced breeding grounds. Why? This is a question that nobody's answered.
Well, perhaps Ford Bell had the answer. I think he advocates knocking off the hunting pressure for a year or 2 years or even 5 years.
Well, Ford Bell...
A step in the right direction, perhaps. Eliminate hunting for a year or two and allow the waterfowl to increase. And if the government proposal to reduce the drainage becomes effective, the problem would seem to be solved. But other threats appear. Some years, hundreds of thousands of birds die from a disease called botulism. And the sturdy and prolific carp, brought from Europe more than a century ago, have overtaken many marshes, feeding on and destroying vegetation needed by waterfowl. And then there is the question of insecticides. The late Rachel Carson, in her book Silent Spring, which tells in frightening terms the effect of indiscriminate chemical spraying, had this to say. Who has made the decision that sets in motion this ever-widening wave of death that spreads out like ripples when a pebble is dropped into a still pond? Who has the right to decide that the supreme value is a world without insects, even though it be also a sterile world ungraced by the curving wing of a bird in flight? The decision is that of the authoritarian, temporarily entrusted with power. He has made it during a moment of inattention by millions to whom beauty and the ordered world of nature still have a meaning that is deep and imperative. Thank you.
One day there came the familiar sound all over again. You looked up, and there they were, the first of the geese coming in from the north. Autumn on the prairies now, the time of the great migrations, when the geese mingle with the ducklings of early summer, now full grown, and joined by the sandhill cranes. The great flocks of the prairie marshes in full view, fattening on the ripened grain in preparation for the long flight south. You watch them go, knowing that next spring many would return unerringly to the very corner of the marsh where they were born. Though the birds were gone, the sense of adventure and discovery remained. And sometimes you came upon the past, a skeleton from a time long gone when far more than now, man depended on the wildlife of the marshes. Less than 100 years ago, herds of buffalo, 50,000 strong, drank at the edge of the marshes and sustained the life of nomadic tribes that were here centuries before the rest of us. Our own forebears traveled west, living off the land as best they could. When small game ran thin, as it sometimes did, they turned to the abundance of wildfowl and the watery lands that gave refuge to the birds. The Western pioneers saw the great whooping crane as few today will view this glorious bird. Happily, the extinction of this species no longer seems imminent. But where once there were thousands, now there are barely more than 40 in all of North America. Certainly today, the hardy blackbird seems secure. But only yesterday, the same was said for the passenger pigeon, now remembered only through the picture books of naturalists. On the marshes of yesteryear, there was also a special breed of men whose ranks are thinning now. The men who made the decoys, laid the trap lines, and served as guides for the people who came from the cities with hip waders and shotguns. October on the prairie is the time of the hunter. Not every man can shoot a bird on the wing. Some are inhibited by a lack of skill, others by a heightened sensitivity toward God's creatures. Significantly, many of the great conservationists are also responsible hunters, outraged by indiscriminate slaughter, but at the same time, aware that killing is an eternal component in the balance of nature. For them, or perhaps I should say for us, a day on the marsh works a small miracle in the recreation of the human spirit. In more practical terms, hunting on the marshes can be described as a major industry, contributing millions of dollars to the nation's economy every year. Areas of conservation, and indeed of morality, there are no final answers, only interesting speculation.
Now, suppose that all of the realistic laws that can be set by man in so far as hunting is concerned were realized and effective. What would you say our other obligations are?
Well, I think our obligation is to leave a heritage for those to come beyond.
What kind of heritage?
A heritage of naturalness. A heritage of a world only partly spoiled. What kind of a world will this be? What kind of a people will we be in 10, 15, 20, 100 years without birds against the sky?
What kind of world would it be? What kind of people will we be? Search our consciences. We hold the answers to our own destiny and that of our nation so richly endowed.
But our cue is to be as conservative as possible until that time arrives, and to save the environment around us, not because of wildfowl to shoot, not because of hunting or the revenue it brings in, but because we as a people will be unable to live and grow if this environment is upset.
When the birds leave their home in the marshland for the place where warm waters lie, will they come back again to the marshland, or then will the spring bear a cold, silent sky? And it calls me still, and it calls me still. Come back to the marshland, 'cause we're fading fast away.
Like winds and sunsets, wild things were taken for granted until progress began to do away with them. Wildlife once fed us and shaped our culture. It still yields us pleasure for leisure hours, but we try to reap that pleasure by modern machinery and thus destroy part of its value. Reaping it by modern mentality would yield not only pleasure, but wisdom as well.
Script editor, Hugh Kemp. The Song of the Marshland was sung by Reg Gibson. Sound effects editor, Luck Johnson.